this was at the end of my talk, but I thought maybe we should just start with this prayer, the prayer of St. Francis. I think it fits well with what we're going to talk about today. So if you'll join me, let's say the prayer of St. Francis. Lord,
make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O my divine Master, grant that I may not so much speak to the eating soul as to the soul, to be understood as to understand, to be loved.
Can you report to the gym, please? If the kids want to come up here, I will get my wife. Okay. So, we've been going through the joy of the gospel, and we're up to the chapter on the social dimension of evangelization. We've got two chapters left, and then our final session is really about our parish and how we're going to use all this stuff in our own parish. So I think at the beginning of this chapter, Pope Francis really wants to help us look through the lens of God, to see other people as God sees other people. So he kind of goes through the perspective of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And he says of God the Father, to believe in a Father who loves all men and women with an infinite love means realizing that he thereby confers upon them an infinite dignity. And so, looking at it through the eyes of a father, you know, a father is going to have, you know, see every one of his children with an infinite dignity. And we have to look at every single person as a child of God. You know, when you talk about, you know, I mean, a lot of people, when they talk about, you know, difficult issues like pornography, they say, well, you know, that's somebody's daughter. And when we talk about the poor, we talk about those who are mistreated, those who are marginalized in society, that's God's children. And so he wants us to look through the lens of how does God see this through God's eyes, as a father, through God the Son. To believe that the Son of God assumed our human flesh means that each person, each human person, has been taken up into the very heart of God. To believe that Jesus shed his blood for us removes any doubt about the boundless love which ennobles each human being. Our redemption has a social dimension because God in Christ redeems not only the individual person, but all the social relations existing between men. And again, it's kind of like we're all brothers and sisters. And as parents, you know, like, it really pains you when your children are fighting. And it's the same thing here. We can see by a crucifix that God believes every human person is worth dying for. Worth every drop of his blood. You know, you've heard it said that if you were the only person on earth, Jesus would have gone through that all just for you, and just for your brother, just for your sister. And so that proves to us how much God believes in the dignity of every single human life. And so we should also believe in the dignity and respect every single human life. We should see every one of them as our brothers and sisters. And the Holy Spirit. To believe that the Holy Spirit is at work in everyone means realizing that he seeks to penetrate every human situation and all social bonds. John Paul II said, "The Holy Spirit can be said to possess an infinite creativity, proper to the divine mind, which knows how to loosen the knots of human affairs, even the most complex and inscrutable." Evangelization is meant to cooperate with this liberating work of the Spirit. And so, we look at the world, and we look at the news, and we look at the problems, and we look at the fighting, and we look at the war, and we look at all of these things, and it just seems like there is no way that we can have peace. There's no way we can get along. But we can't remember the power of the Holy Spirit. And John Paul II said, the Holy Spirit knows how to loosen the knots of human affairs, even the most complex. And evangelization means we have to cooperate with that. A couple of sessions ago, we talked about the pessimistic attitude. If we go into this already believing that we can't win, then we can't win. We have to be optimistic that we can have peace, we can have dialogue, we can work together, we can be unified in this work. So Real faith is not a private matter. It's a social one. God wants all people to be happy in this world as well as eternally. Real faith desires to change the world. And so we're not supposed to keep our faith to ourselves. That's kind of what the culture wants sometimes, to keep your faith to yourself. But who would have ever told St. Francis, keep your faith to yourself, or Mother Teresa, just keep your faith to yourself. And the world needs faith. The world needs the witnesses of saints. And the real work of the church is really to serve. Who doesn't want people to serve? To lay down their lives for other people? You know, we still talk about these people. St. Francis lived over 800 years ago. 800 years ago, we named cities after him. We say prayers about him. Secular people do. He's captured the minds and the imagination of the whole world. Nobody doesn't know who St. Francis is because he lived his faith. He didn't keep it to himself. He showed us what it means to be Jesus Christ to other people. And that inspires people. That catches people's attention. That's how the Christian church grew. And in the beginning, look how they love each other. It's something the world had never seen before. And it's something that we all long for. And so it is attractive, and it should be attractive, and it shouldn't be something that just you do on Sunday, you keep it to yourself. You know, we have to be able to share our faith with others. It's a social thing. We're all in this together. I like this reading. We heard some of this today, actually, but this past week in Texas, I was there with Rachel and Cassandra, and I was, you know, Father Tim had taught me the Lexio Divina, and I wanted to share with the girls to show them how to do this. And so this whole week we've been doing it with the readings, and I believe this was Thursday's reading, the first reading. And we're not going to do the whole Lexio Divina process, but I want you to kind of listen to this reading and, you know, see how this relates to what we're talking about today as far as the social dimension of sharing the joy of the gospel. Beloved, we love God because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, but hates his brother, he is a liar. For whoever does not love a brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. This is the commandment we have from him. Whoever loves God must also love his brother. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is begotten by God, and everyone who loves the Father loves also the one begotten by him. In this way we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. For whoever is begotten by God conquers the world, and the victory that conquers the world is our faith. We can't say, I love God, but I don't care about that other person. That is God. You know, that is Jesus Christ in the flesh. That is Jesus in his distress in disguise. And we're in this together. And so we have to live our faith. Our faith isn't just something we believe. Our faith, the victory that conquers the world is our faith. But that's not going to conquer the world to just go around and say, I believe in Jesus Christ. The devil believes in Jesus Christ. Faith is not just something we believe. It's something we do. If you love me, obey my commandments. If you love me, feed my sheep. If you love me, feed my lambs. You know, I heard a story about, somebody used this analogy once, and I think it really worked for me as far as faith and works. There was this guy that was going to walk across Niagara Falls on a tightrope, you know, this acrobatic guy, and everybody, there's a big crowd there, and he looks around and he says, do you guys think I can walk across Niagara Falls on this tightrope? And everybody's like, yeah, we believe you can do it. And so he gets on the tightrope, and he's walking across Niagara Falls. And after about an hour, he makes it all the way across Niagara Falls successfully to the other side, and everybody cheers. And he says, thank you, but I think I can do even more. I think I can walk back across Niagara Falls on this tightrope with a blindfold over my eyes. Do you think I can do it? And everybody said, yeah, we believe you can do it. And so he puts the blindfold on, he gets back on there, and he goes back across, all the way across. And after an hour or so, he makes it back across, and everybody cheers. And he says, I think I can do even more. I think I can walk back across this tightrope over Niagara Falls with a blindfold and a man on my back. Do you believe I can do it? We believe you can do it. We believe you can do it. Okay, can I have a volunteer? Nobody volunteers. Do you believe? Do you really believe? Faith requires action. We have to do something with that. And so we have to love one another. We have to obey his commandments if we really love him, if we believe in him, if we have faith in him. You know, Jesus' faith in his Father was, you know, everything. I mean, he believed his Father so much. He trusted his Father so much. He was willing to be crucified, knowing that even if I die, he will raise me up again. Even if I die, I trust the Father that much. And so that's what faith is about. We have to believe. There's two focuses of Pope Francis in this chapter. He says, I'm not going to talk about all of the social, you know, issues in our world today. In fact, he wants us to talk about them ourselves in our own communities, because there's not a one-size-fits-all to fix these problems. You can't just have a list of things that everybody has to do, or a list of, you know, a government situation and this law is going to fix everything. There's no law that can fix everything. We have to be able to, it takes people to fix the problem, not a law. You know, there's no law that's going to work. It takes presidents and employees and employers and CEOs and everybody trying to become who they were created to be. And it's up to the politicians and all those people to give us the best situation to be able to do that, and to give us the best incentive to do that. But it's up to us to actually make it happen. You know, the founders of our country said this Constitution, it's not going to work without a moral society. If people aren't striving for virtue and trying to do their best, it's going to collapse, and you can see it collapsing. And so he's just going to give us two samples, and he wants us to talk about it ourselves. He wants us to dial, and he wants us to search for problems in our own situation, in our own lands. And so the first is the poor. You know that Pope Francis has a special place in his heart for the poor. You know, you see this theme over and over, that we have to love the poor. And I thought about, when I was reading this, I thought about St. Lawrence. You know, St. Lawrence lived, I think, in the 3rd century. And it was at that time where Christianity is still legal in the Roman Empire. And there was, the emperor at the time had, you know, had enough of the Christians speaking about their faith and everything, and he had had this decree out to murder the Pope or something. And so the Pope knew this, and so he transferred all of the treasures of the church over to Lawrence, and he kind of knew his death was coming. And so they transferred everything, and the Pope was martyred, and they knew that Lawrence was kind of like the guy that he passed everything on to, and all the treasury of the church. And they brought in Lawrence, and they were going to execute Lawrence, but they said, you have 3 days to go collect. I want all the treasury of the church. I want you to bring all the treasury of the church to me. And so St. Lawrence said, okay. And he went off and he started selling everything the church had and giving it to the poor. He sold everything and he gave it to the poor. And then he brought all the poor in crowds and droves up to the emperor. And he came back and he said, this is the treasury of the church. Right here. This is her treasury, the poor. And of course they executed St. Lawrence, and his last act was, you know, an act of humor. He was barbecued, you know, and they said that when he was being barbecued, after a while he said, all right, you can turn me over, I'm done on this side. And, you know, he loved God, he trusted God, he knew the treasury of the church with the poor, and he knew his kingdom was heaven. And we should be the same way. Our kingdom is heaven. Our brothers and sisters, we should want to take with us, and we know that the poor is the treasure. You know, Simon of Cyrene, again, I saw this in there, and it reminded me of Simon of Cyrene. He said, we must be deeply moved by the suffering of others. Again, these are God's children. These are God's children. If you see a baby on its own on the street or before, I mean, you want to help the little child. Everybody we see is a child of God. You know, and you don't see it that much. In my sheltered little life, I just haven't seen it. But when I was in Fort Worth in Texas, I got lost in the city. I'm not very good at driving around the city. I got lost in the city, and I was going through the city, and there was this part of the city we were going through, and there was this kind of bridge. And underneath the bridge, I don't know if it was like a shelter or what was there, what they were waiting for, but along the bridge, underneath, there was just a whole village of people, sleeping bags. They were just laying on the sidewalk in sleeping bags and blankets. I mean, hundreds of them. And they were just sitting there on the side of the road. And we can't help. How does that happen in our country? Where we have to be deeply moved by the suffering of others. And Simon of Cyrene, when he encountered Christ, it changed him. Every character that actually encounters Christ in the Bible is deeply changed. Everybody, read the stories, you know, whether it's the prostitute or, you know, Simon of Cyrene or the apostles. Whenever they encounter Jesus, they are deeply moved. And Simon encounters Jesus when he's at his deepest suffering. And he doesn't want to help at first. He wants to avoid the situation altogether. But I like that movie, The Passion of the Christ, because you can see the transformation of Simon as he carries the cross with Jesus. By the end, they can't even get him away. He wants to help. And it's only in helping that he encounters that. It's not by sending a check overseas. You don't actually encounter the person that way. Simon encountered the suffering of Jesus, and he couldn't help but want to carry the cross with him. I saw this study a while back. I used to use this statistic when I did in-services at my nursing homes, but it was a government study in 2007 which announced the jobs that have the highest rate of depression in the United States. Number one, taking care of the elderly, handicapped, and children. Number two is food service. Number three, healthcare, social work. Now, I am a healthcare worker who takes care of the elderly and the handicapped, only to come home to small children. So based on this study, I should be jumping out of windows, you know? What do these all have in common? Serving other people that just service, and most of them involve serving people that really can't give you anything back. And if we're gonna go through life asking the question, what's in it for me? These are depressing. They're depressing. I work with a lot of depressed people. I work with a lot of Alzheimer's people. It is hard to work with people that are depressed, people that are hurting, people that are suffering. But if we know who we are and why we're here, we're made in the image and likeness of God, a God who came and made himself a slave to serve, not to be served, and that we can image him, and that our purpose and our meaning comes from giving ourselves away. We find ourselves by giving ourselves away. Then these are the most joyful jobs I can find. I love my life. I love my job. I love my wife and children, even though those children constantly require service. And they really can't give you a whole lot back except love. You know? And if you're going to go serving people looking for the reward, you're going to be depressed. And it is depressing because we've stopped asking how can I serve, and we started asking what's in it for me. There's not much in it when you have to give everything and your reward is in heaven. If you removed heaven, if you removed the mission, if you removed the goal and the purpose, then life is depressing. If you remove God from society, it becomes about maximizing pleasure and minimizing pain. And if that's the purpose and meaning of life, then you're going to avoid the poor at all costs. You're going to avoid suffering at all costs. You're going to avoid the people who are hurting because you don't want any part of it. You got to know who you are. You got to know what your mission is. You got to remember your purpose. Pope Francis said, I want a poor church for the poor because they have something to teach us. You know, I can't remember who it was, but there was a bishop who was giving a talk to a group of really wealthy people. And he said, the poor need you. The poor need you to keep them out of poverty, to keep them out of, you know, sickness, to keep them alive. The poor need you, and you need the poor to keep you out of hell. You need the poor. You know, these are pretty blunt statements. Archbishop Shapiro said, if we don't love the poor and do all we can to improve their lot, we're going to go to hell. It's very clear from the Gospels that we have a duty to do that. Read the story of Lazarus and the rich man who just stepped over him every day. It didn't turn out very well for him. We have to help the poor because it helps us. You know, as a young lady, I was trying to get this concept across to her that life is about who we become, not about what we do and have. But she's like, well, so then I don't have to do anything? I'm like, no, you have to do something because it helps you become. Like, so if I fail, then I fail God if I don't accomplish. No, God doesn't need you. to do anything. He doesn't need your help. Well, then why do I have to do anything? Because it helps you. It's part of your journey. Maybe that poor person is there for your salvation. By helping them, you discover your purpose. You know, I would say, well, I try to use the analogy of becoming a doctor. You know, if somebody gives me a free ride through college and optometry school, like $100,000, whatever you need, free ride, it's all paid for. Like, yes, I don't have to pay anything. It's a free ride. But I still have to go to class. Are you going to come to me and let me take a needle and get something out of your eye? It's okay. I've had a free ride. My college is paid for. Yeah, but you don't know what you're doing, you know? You have to go through the process. You have to say, yes, faith requires action. You've got to come out of your prison cell. You know, we were prisoners, and Jesus paid the price. He paid the bail, but we have to come out of the cell. We have to go through the process. You know, you can't be a parent and not become a better person. Those children save you. You don't save them. They teach you to give your life away in a way that you want to. I mean, to love a child, the love you have for your children, you do anything for them. And so you get a small glimpse of what it means to love as God loves. To serve another person without asking what's in it for me or what it didn't give me in return. We need the poor because they teach us something. You know, and they need us because we're in this together. Affirming and supporting human dignity should be the aim of every economic system. And so, again, we have to ask too, what does it mean to help? And what does it mean to love? You know, because it's not just going to be a law that fixes this. You know, the only insurance I work with is Medicare and Medicaid. These are government programs to help people that have no money. And they're wonderful services to humanity. It's a wonderful thing that we do as a country to try to want to help everybody. But they can become a problem if we don't teach virtue along with them. If we don't teach people how to fish, we just keep giving them the fish without teaching them how to fish, helping them reach their fullest potential. And I was in a nursing home once, and we provide, you know, glasses through Medicaid, and if the people break their glasses or lose their glasses, our company replaces them for free. It's just one of our services. And there was a lady in the nursing home, her glasses broke, and she was so angry that the social worker was standing there. She was cussing out the social worker, and she threw the glasses at her, and she made the social worker cry. She said, "This is ridiculous, this service that you're providing." Because she wanted a high-end frame. She wanted whatever, you know, they had at the store. We didn't, you know. And she forgot she lives in a country that wants to help everyone. And just because she was in a suffering, I mean, she was suffering, she was in a situation, she couldn't help herself, but she deserved, I deserve whatever I want. That's not helping the other person. That's giving them a crutch. We have to help them. And that's hard to do, because in every situation, it's probably going to be different. You know, I had patients also that would come in and they were on their Medicaid and they were talking about their job, and I said, yeah, I got offered this job, but the increase in pay would be too much. I'd lose my Medicaid and the insurance isn't near as good. And so they turned the job down. Are we helping them reach their fullest potential? Or are we giving them crutches and trying to keep them at a lower level? And so it's a very hard question to ask. That's why every human person has to be striving to become the best person they can be, or the whole system fails. From top to bottom, it's about winning the war within, and every person striving to be saints, or the system fails. And so, respecting and supporting the human dignity means teaching them, not just acting like they're not capable of doing anything, or, you know, but to help them, to teach them, to help them find who they are and reach their fullest potential, whatever that means. The church has a great love and concern for unborn children and women in crisis pregnancies. And so he talks about the smallest of children. We have to value the dignity and respect of every human life. And so the church is not going to budge on this. It's never loving to destroy a child to try to prevent more suffering. But at the same time, we also have to find ways to help people in crisis pregnancies. You know, it goes both ways in the church. You can't just harp on abortion, but then not help, you know, people that are in difficult situations. We have to look at their situation. We have to want to relieve their suffering. And we also want to have to try to prevent that suffering from happening in the first place. And he also talks about the environment, God's creation. We have to have respect for the environment around us. This is, God's creation. He gave it to us, but we also have to respect it and take care of the creation that he gave us. The second part of the chapter is about peace and social dialogue. How do we start talking about some of these things? We have to be able to talk about difficult issues. We have to be able to dialogue about difficult issues. And he gives four principles for maintaining peace, maintaining dialogue, social dialogue. Number one, what I call the long view. He said, long-term plans unfold at their own pace, even if short-term gains elude us. And so he kind of mentions politics again. Sometimes to win an election, we come up with this short-term plan. It's all about the short-term, but we're not really looking long-term. And he said, we got to look at the long view, what's going to be best in the long run, and not get discouraged by every little, temporary failure. Things, we have to be patient. We have to be patient and let things take forward. And this is what I love about the Catholic Church. She always takes the long view. The long view, all things in time. And that's why we build cathedrals. That's why we build, the cathedrals that were built in the Middle Ages. They're the only structures that were built at that time period that are still being used for the purpose with which they were created. Because the church has a long view. That cathedral, over the centuries, it's going to reveal the beauty and mystery of God's love to the world. And people say, well, it's not worth building something like that. If you're going to build something, just take it down. And give the money to, you hear that all the time. It's not worth building a cathedral to those Catholics, Just give the money to the poor if you want to help them. Well, that is helping the poor. Those cathedrals are helping the poor. I'm sure they give jobs to lots and lots and lots of people. And they give shelter to lots and lots and lots of people. And they give some places for people to come and encounter God in the universe, not just for a couple years, but for centuries and centuries and centuries. And we look at the long view. So he said, you got to look at the long view sometimes and let the plans unfold. Even if short-term gains, sometimes you get hurt in the short run to get the long run. That's why I tell people at work, to get ahead, if you lie, you get ahead. You can get more money. But in the long run, is that going to help me become a saint? The long view is what's going to help get us to heaven, not what's going to give us this temporary short-term gain. The second principle is resolving conflict. He said, some people see conflict and they ignore it. Others become swamped by it. But a third option is to confront it and use it to build a better society, to hold unity as a value. Unity is a value. And so conflict is part of life. We have to be able to dialogue. We might disagree on certain things. But if we can come to at least a unity, for instance, every human being deserves to be treated with dignity and respect. Every human being deserves to be loved. I would like to start every conversation with that. Do you believe that? I believe that. And if the other person believes that, we have a unity. We have a common ground. You want to do what's best for all people. I want to do what's best. I want to help all people. And I think they deserve to be treated with dignity and respect. Now we can have a dialogue. You might think this means treating them with dignity and respect, and I might think that means treating them with dignity and respect. But at least I can look at you as somebody that they want to help. I got in a conversation once with a good friend, and I was surprised during the conversation to find that their view on abortion was different than mine. And this is somebody that I have great respect for, great admiration for, and I know they're a really, really good person, and they want to do what's right, they want to help people, they want to relieve suffering, and that was their mission, that was their goal, and I can respect that. I'm certainly never going to agree with their view that abortion is the right thing to do, but I can dialogue with them and say, well, why do you think that's the best thing for them? And I can listen to what they said, and they can listen to me, respecting, knowing that I really want to help the other person too, I want to do what's best for them. But you have to have the unity to hold you in place. You have to know what the goal is and the purpose is. But sometimes we look at issues and we think those people are evil and we're good. And they want to do evil. That's their goal, is to do evil. Well, their intention isn't to do evil. But if we can't dialogue, then we're never going to explain to them and show them how maybe that is evil. And so we have to be able to dialogue and maybe sometimes have conflict. That's how the church resolves conflicts. That's what they do when they hold councils. We have a problem. Okay, well, let's go talk about it. And they oftentimes disagree. And that's part of the process sometimes to resolving conflict. The third principle, realities are greater than ideas. So not to put the word into practice, not to make it a reality, is to build on sand. Sometimes we have great ideas and it all looks good in our mind, but in reality, is it really there? You know, it's easy to say something, but people don't want them just to tell them about Jesus Christ. They want them to show them. It has to be a reality. It has to be put into practice. It can't be just an idealistic idea that can never become. So he's saying we got to look at the reality and the suffering that people are going through and their situation. You know, I think it goes back to the whole idea of when he talked about the battlefield and treating the mortal wounds first. You know, you can't lecture somebody about diabetes if they have a mortal wound. You got to treat that first, right? The reality is they're dying, and lecturing about their diabetes is not helping at that point. You know, first you got to treat the wound. So you got to look at the reality they're in and be where they're at and have that compassion, suffer with them and help them through that process in a way that is feasible and makes sense to them, and not speak over their head. Meet them where they're at, in other words. I think that's what this means. Meet them where they're at. The fourth principle, the whole is greater than the part. And so I read this a couple times, and I think he's talking about, you know, local things versus global things. Sometimes we get wrapped in our own little world, and our own little customs, and our own little ideas, and sometimes those are great things, they are good things, and we do have just different customs, and we should celebrate those things, but we never need to, we must always remember we're part of a greater reality, and the whole reality is a whole, that we're one, the whole world is one. Because people on the other side of the world are our brothers and sisters too, and we're not just in our own little cluster. We have to get outside of ourselves sometimes, and again, you see this a lot of times with churches. I'm not going to that church. That's not my parish, you know. I'm not going to that building. That's not my building. And forget what the building is, what the church is. The church is the people, not the building. If we could work together, I mean, different parishes have different ministries that are really good. You know, what if we combine forces? The Catholic Church, more than anybody, if you could just work together, we wouldn't need a healthcare system. We have enough people. We could be able to treat each other if we all work together. You know, one parish might have an awesome youth group, another parish might have an awesome pre-K, and we can work together. We're one church. We can't keep going through the attitude of, this is my building, this is my church, because then we've lost the idea of what a church really is. We have to be one. We have to look at the big picture. Social dialogue. We just talked about this. We must be able to dialogue in peaceful ways. And I think Dorothy Day is a good example of this. He goes through all the different things, like faith and science and the Muslims and the atheists. And we have to be able to dialogue with everybody because there's traces of God everywhere. Even among the atheists, even among every different religion, there's some truth. There's some beauty of God and His creation. And so, again, finding that common unity, I think, is key. And then dialoguing about, you know, how can we reach that common unity. And Dorothy Day, you know, I think it was Cardinal Dolan that said Dorothy Day is, I think, a good model of what we need for our times. Because Dorothy Day, when she was a social activist, and she spoke out against war, and she spoke about peace, and she spoke about workers' rights, and she did everything she could to make sure everybody had, you know, workers' rights, and she was very big on social justice. But at the same time, she spoke out against contraception. She spoke out against abortion, and nobody could put her finger like, what? Is she liberal? Or is she conservative? Is she Republican? Or is she Democrat? Nothing. Neither one. She's Catholic. She's Catholic. Those political terms, they don't work. They don't work. Because Catholicism is the best of everything. It's not a group. It's the truth. And that's why people can't label Pope Francis. Wait, what? You know? Yeah, in one sentence he says, who am I to judge someone with some same-sex attraction years ago, he said same-sex marriage is something from the devil. Like, wait, what? You know, because he's talking about truth and love. He's talking about not judging people. He's about helping people in the situation you're in, but also he's not about watering down the truth either. He's also about speaking the truth, but he's about speaking it in love. We don't judge people, but we can judge actions. Abortion, murdering people is wrong. It's wrong, you know? And so, but that's part of dialogue. That's part of dialogue. Dialogue doesn't mean just giving up on our beliefs just to keep the peace. It just means being able to speak about our faith in a way that people can understand and not condemn them and judge them and wag fingers at them. Because, you know, the truth is what they are looking for. And I saw this quote from Humani Vitae. This is something that Pope Paul VI said in one of those controversial topics, again, about contraception. This was in 1968 when the whole birth control movement was coming out, and he had to drop this bomb on the world that the church was going to reiterate their teaching on contraception. And after he went through all the problems and he explained why the church warned people that this is going to cause men to lose respect for women, it's going to cause countries to try to control their populations in immoral ways, it's going to cause an increase in divorce, abortions, these things are going to increase, not be, everything he said came true. He explained this. But then he said, it is to be anticipated that perhaps not everyone will easily accept this particular teaching. There is too much clamorous outcry against the voice of the church, and this is intensified by modern means of communication. But it comes as no surprise to the church that she, no less than her divine founder, is destined to be a sign of contradiction. She does not, because of this, evade the duty imposed on her of proclaiming humbly but firmly the entire moral law, both natural and evangelical. Since the church did not make either of these laws, she could not be their arbiter, only their guardian and interpreter. It could never be right for her to declare lawful what is in fact unlawful, since that by its very nature is always opposed to the true good of man. The church believes in the dignity and respect of every human life. She wants to love every person. And hopefully the world can at least see that, even if they disagree with, you know, that what the church teaches is right. Pope Paul VI is saying, I don't even have the authority to change this. The church is only the guardian and interpreter of moral law. And so none of the saints, none of the popes have ever been unfaithful to the church, but they're looking for ways to teach this in a way that people can understand and relate. So it's not just an arbitrary rule. It's not just a condemnation. It's not just a wagging of finger, people. It's meeting them where they're at. If you're going to talk about social justice, you have to talk about contraception and abortion and those things because they go together. And if you're going to harp about contraception and abortion, then you have to talk about social justice and helping the poor and the suffering. It's a both and. It's not an either or. The whole of the faith goes together. This is part of the whole, not the part. We can't just take one bit of the faith. We have to proclaim the whole truth. We can't just try to relieve suffering. We also have to try to prevent suffering. Greg, we saw this yesterday at the men's retreat. And I think it's a powerful scene from the movie Saving Private Ryan towards the end. And I think it's good to reflect on about how we've been given a gift, that Jesus Christ laid down his life so that you could have life. You have this gift. And you get to decide what to do with the gift. You know, I think of it like our progression goes from, you know, I give my son a $5 bill when he's five, he's probably going to go buy some candy or a dinosaur or something with the money right away. You know, but as it gets a little older, I hope the thought process changes to, okay, fine, I'll give a dollar to the church. Fine, I'll give a dollar here because I have to. And then I hope that thought process changes to, I want to. I don't want to keep this for myself. I want to give it away because I've been given gifts. I want to share what I've been given. I want to use this for someone else because he discovers somewhere along the line that's what brings him joy. And this man, if you've never seen the movie, it's about a soldier who all of his brothers had died in war. and his mother is grieving back home, and so they send this clan of six or seven guys, soldiers, to go find Private Ryan to bring him home to his grieving mother. And these six or seven guys end up having to give their life to save the life of this one man. And they, you know, they struggle with this. And they end up giving their life, and at the very end, the captain looks at Private Ryan towards the end as he's dying, and he says, "Earn this." And Private Ryan has to struggle with this his whole life. And you'll see how he struggles with this in this scene in the movie right at the end as he visits the grave of this captain.
Citizens of a grateful nation, wishing you good health and many years of happiness with James at your side. Nothing, not even the safe return from a loved son, can compensate you or the thousands of other American families who have suffered great loss in this tragic war. And I might share with you some words which have sustained me through long dark nights of peril, loss, and heartache. And I quote, "Pray that our Heavenly Father may assuage the anguish of your bereavement and leave you only the cherished memory of the loved and lost and the solemn pride that must be yours to have laid so costly a sacrifice upon the altar of freedom. Abraham Lincoln, yours very sincerely respected, George C. Marshall, General, Chief of Staff."
We can't earn our salvation. It's a free gift. But you get to decide what you do with that gift. You get to decide what you do. And I think we're all called to save Private Ryan, or Private Rachel, or Private Rob, or every soul that we encounter. That's what we're called to do. You know, we have the ability to do that. And that's what your purpose and your meaning in life is. And when you come to see God, you know, and his children, then it's worth giving your life for. And so I thought a good reflection today might be, see, this is a prayer that I say every day. I try to say every day on my way to work, and I'm not sure where I got the prayer, if I just made it up at some point because I'm an eye doctor, but I think it's really helping me. So I want you to think about this prayer. Lord, help me to see you in the eyes of everyone I meet, so that everyone I meet may see you in me. And I want you to talk about how would saying this prayer every morning change your outlook on the people that you encounter that day? The poor, or the annoying person at work, or your children, or whoever it is that you encounter. How is saying this prayer going to change your outlook on those people? So maybe just discuss that question for a few minutes here, and then we'll wrap up. So. Had some good conversation. Does anybody want to share anything that you talked about? Any ideas? I think for me, this relates mostly to those people that I disagree with. People that don't believe what I believe. You know, I think that the sentence helps me in that situation even more than, I know that the poor and the elderly and the handicapped are Jesus in disguise, but sometimes it's hard to see Jesus in the ones that want to persecute you or disagree with you or get angry at the church or whoever. So again, that's what Pope Francis is talking about with dialogue and meeting people where they're at and seeing them in their situation and listening to them. So maybe we can see why do they believe what they believe, how have they been hurt, how have they been raised and how they've been educated. There's lots of things that form our opinions and our ideas, and so we have to dialogue about those things so we can see what formed their opinions and their ideas and see the suffering that they may be going through and explain to them ways that we can help. So I remember in college, Kristen's sister actually got pregnant in college. It was just a difficult time, trying to understand the whole idea of abortion. That's been very helpful for me, that experience. I don't know what went through my sister-in-law's mind, but I'm very proud of how she handled the situation. She was, the valedictorian, the captain of charge of pastoral council, very faithful Catholic, very, beautiful girl. And now she's in this situation, has a bright future. And so she actually stayed with us for about a year. Isabel and little Claire, they were kind of born at the same time, so we had two little babies for that first year, and it was just a great experience, I think, for all of us in that situation to see the value of that life and where she's gone from there. She's able to keep going to school and just graduated as a nurse, and now she has three little girls, and just to see the tragedy that would have been to get rid of that little girl, looking back, and even though it was hard, I think that's ways to dialogue with people about, I know you're in a difficult situation, but things can get better, and this can work out for the good kind of thing. So, anything else for you? I do have the little gospel thing, it's 2 minutes long. If you want to watch that, and then we'll be all set here, okay? And I think this video relates to what we're talking about today, because we're all looking for something. And it's not really the things of this world. It's about giving ourselves away, I think.
Hey, everybody. So in the gospel, Jesus asks his disciples.
Can everybody hear it? Is that right?
Not
fun.
Really?
Well, after a life of some serious looking in all wrong places, a man named Augustine finally looked to God. He said our hearts will be restless until we rest in Him. He became a saint. That's our ultimate purpose, to look for Jesus and embrace Him to become saints. This is our great adventure. Go to massimpact.us and download the Live It Gatsby Guide. I mean, right now. It's a great way for us families to talk and pray, to be formed by Him who is love. Set aside your phones, your gadgets, your devices for just 30 minutes. You can do this. Come on, let's get going. Trust me, it'll be the best time you've spent with your family in a long, long time. For real, and I'm not lying. We'll meet you this Sunday in the Eucharist to know how truly, deeply God loves you.
Soup today, and try to stay for it. See you next time.